इन टुडेज लेक्चर आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट लॉजिकल कनेक्टिव्स एंड क्वांटिफायर्स. इन प्रीवियस टू लेक्चर्स आई हैव टॉक अबाउट द एक्सियम्स, डिफिनीशंस एंड आफ्टर दैट थ्योरम्स एंड इट्स वेरिएंट. एंड मेन मोटिव ऑफ टुडेज लेक्चर टू apply logical connectives to proposition, and it is possible to show that we are going to get some new proposition. That is the main motive of the lecture. So suppose that if I have finite many proposition, so from finite many proposition we have already seen that some kind of sentence that is either true or false. So using help of that proposition, one can develop the new proposition. That is the main motivation. And you can see that one of the most important proposition is called, or one of the most important connectives is called the negation of a proposition. So I have certain proposition P. So here I have, you can assume that any sentence, any logical sentence means that is not confusing. They have either two value, either that is true or false. So whenever I am going to talk about sentence, then at that time I am assuming that this P, mathematical sentence, is either true or false. So there is no confusion. So one result surely will come, then only we will tell that as a proposition. Now, whenever we add this kind of symbol or this kind of connectives to the proposition, it means that we are talking about the negation. So if something is false, then negation of this, that is true. And if P is false, then negation of that is always true. Because we are very much, or we are pretty sure that P is either true or false. So similarly, I can able to comment about negation of P. Okay. So suppose that if I write some kind of definition and I have to find some negative definition, then just you have to add this kind of negation symbol. So let us try to see, this is symbol of negation. So I have here recalled the definition of epsilon and delta stability. So for time being, I'm not going to talk much about what is meaning of stable, what is meaning of unstable. Let us try to just focus on this particular definition. So I have written some definition of stability. In the further part of this course, you are going to learn about the stability. So meaning of stability is like this. Suppose that you have some system like x dot equal to fx. So how basically we are interpreting this system? Here x belongs to Rn. So we are interpreting system like this. I have certain kind of function, and after that you can see in this particular framework that only thing, everything is autonomous. Autonomous means I have some x0. If I will substitute here, then I am going to generate xt, and I can able to generate xt like this, xt equal to xt0 integral t0 to t f tau into d tau. So here fx tau into d tau, so x is there. So if I have some initial condition t equal to t0, then I am telling that if you give here xt0, then, and if you know this function, then for all time I am going to generate xt. So now you can interpret x0 as the input of the system, means initial condition is only input of the system, and xt is the output of the system. And basically, whenever we are talking about equilibrium point, at that time we are talking about the rate of change of some quantity equal to 0. So here you can see that x you can interpret as a position vector, then you can interpret x dot as a velocity vector. X belongs to Rn. It means that I am talking about x1, x2 up to xn. So n number of component here. So you can interpret this as a position vector. So x dot is derivative of each and every component, that is velocity vector. So applying Newton's law that if velocity is zero, then whatever position that not going to change. So without loss of generality, I am assuming that equilibrium point x equal to zero and that solution is x equal to zero. So due to that reason, in this particular definition I have taken like this. I will come up with this in the later part of course, I have already told you. So whenever we are talking about stability, at that time we are telling that, again like continuity, in previous class we have discussed about the continuity, we are telling that first we are selecting the output ball. So here in this particular block diagram you can see that xt is my output and I have selected output ball epsilon. So for each means I will interpret each. In today's lecture I am also coming to each, every, why we are writing like this. So we are basically telling for every epsilon there exists a delta, and delta is function of epsilon, both are greater than zero, such that if you start from the input ball, so you can draw like this. Suppose this is equilibrium point. Now this is higher dimensional system. So higher dimensional system, if you are using this kind of symbol, that is called norm. It means that you are talking about distance from some reference point. So equilibrium point is here. And after that, now you try to see that what I am going to do. Suppose this is my output ball. First, I have told you that I have to select the specification, and due to that reason, we are constructing this ball with respect to origin. So this is my xt. And after that, we are telling that if system is stable, then corresponding to output ball, there exists a input ball, that is function of epsilon, that is again greater than zero. So this particular quantity is input ball. So xt0 means ball of initial condition. So if you start from here, you are going to stay here. If we are going to give this kind of guarantee, then we are telling that equilibrium point of this system x dot equal to fx, that is stable. Please be careful, I am not telling that system is stable, just I am telling that equilibrium point is stable. So suppose if I believe on this definition, so whenever you are stating some definition, it means that you are going to capture some kind of property. And what is meaning of this property? You are telling that if you start from equilibrium point, then you are going to stay there because there is no disturbance. But if you start nearby of the equilibrium point, then what is your behavior? So either you are going to remain in the neighborhood of the equilibrium point, or you will go beyond or go very large distance from the equilibrium point. So for that we have coined this definition of stable. Stable means we are going to stay nearby of the equilibrium point. So now negation of stability, what one can think? Anyone? Suppose that I know the stability means something is going to remain nearby of the equilibrium point if we start nearby of the equilibrium point. So what do you think? What is the negation of this? Anyone?
So it is not the case that a system will be stable.
Yeah, so that is called unstable. So now for unstability or unstable system, there is no need to give separate definition, just you can apply this negation symbol. And you can see that I have symbolized this above sentence. So for this notion I have already told you in previous class, that is for all. Today's lecture I am going to revise it in a very careful manner. This symbol is there exists, delta epsilon greater than zero, and here I have ball of initial condition. So if you start from here, you are going to live here for all t greater than equal to zero. So up to here I have definition of stability about the equilibrium point, because I am just concentrating I have constructed ball about the equilibrium point. So we are whenever we are putting negation symbol, it means that we are talking about the unstability or instability, people are telling. So negation, due to that reason, negation is very, very important, because if you coined one definition, then negation of that will give another definition. So in this way, somehow you can see that I have some kind of proposition. So now I am going to develop new proposition just by adding some kind of connectives, and here connectives is nothing but negation. So this is one of the fundamental connectives. And after that, I have two more connectives, and that is conjunction and disjunction. And I hope that you are already well aware about this. So just I'm going to define. So suppose now I have two proposition. So here you can see that I have just single proposition, and adding negation, I am going to generate some new proposition. But whenever we are talking about conjunction and disjunction, at that time I am going to talk about at least two propositions. And here meaning of conjunction is nothing but P conjunction Q is the proposition P and Q. So it means that when P and Q is true, exactly when both P and Q are true. So in this way, I am going to interpret this conjunction, this connectives conjunction. So P conjunction Q, we are going to read like this. So this is true if P has true value and Q also has true value. That is the meaning. Now, whenever we are talking about disjunction, so somehow we are talking about and or a statement or some kind of things we have already learned about and or. So similar kind of things we are talking here. So whenever we are talking about disjunction of two sentences or two proposition, then at that time we are going to use this symbol. So this is P disjunction Q, and meaning of this is that at least one of them, either P or Q, is true. So it might possible sometime P might be true and Q might be false, but sometime P is false and Q is true, or sometime it might possible P is also true, Q is also true. But this is not the situation that P is false and Q is false. So we are going to avoid this kind of situation. Okay, and if you see the literature of nonlinear control, so most of time we are not going to use and word. Sometime you see that people are using but, while, although. So you have to translate this particular word, English word, like the and, means we are going to talk about conjunction. So even if explicitly conjunction is not written, but you have to interpret that as a conjunction. That kind of message I am going to transmit. Okay, anyone has confusion? So whenever but, while, and although is written, then also I am going to interpret that as a and. So I have taken very very simple example. 19 is not composite, but 45 is a multiple of 3. So I am not going to understand what is meaning of sentence, just I am going to symbolize. So 19 is composite, suppose that is one sentence, and I have written that by C, and 45 is a multiple of 3, that is by M, then I am going to write like this. So you can see that I have written here, I am going to add one connectives, that negation of C, and this is nothing but here I am going to talk about the conjunction, and after that I am going to put this symbol. So in this way we are going to interpret. So here but is interpreted as a and. And so please be careful whenever you are reading any sentences or any literature in nonlinear control or mathematics. Now I have three different things here, that negation, conjunction and disjunction. So all are going to generate some kind of new proposition. So I have some existing proposition, and after that we are generating some new proposition. Again, using these two connectives, you can tell that conditional and biconditional, again I am going to generate some more proposition. So you might have seen that whenever I am writing theorem in previous class, we are using if and then. So this is one of the most important kind of proposition in mathematics, because whenever I am going to state the theorem, I am going to use this kind of connectives, if and then. That is called conditional, some kind of condition. And I have told you in previous class that whenever I am writing like this, it means that we are assuming that if P is true, P implies Q is true, then Q is also true. That is the meaning of this particular.
Yes.
Okay, so sorry for the disturbance. Okay. So now what basically I'm telling that this sentence that is called conditional. Conditional means I'm talking about some kind of conditional proposition when their combined value will true. It means that I'm talking about P is true, P implies Q is true, then Q is true or not. So I can give guarantee. So these kind of basically proposition is very, very common. So whenever we are stating some kind of theorem in basically mathematics or in control system, nonlinear control system or control system, we are going to use these kind of conditional propositions. So this is from pre-calculus. If two lines in plane have same slope, then the lines are parallel. So again, you can see that if and then is here. Similarly, if and then is here. Similarly, if and then is here. So like this. So now let us come to the definition, because from last class or it might possibly in previous class also, previous to previous class, I was talking about this particular symbol, conditional symbol, but I haven't defined it. So in today's lecture, I'm going to define it. So for propositions P and Q, the conditional sentence, this is called conditional sentence, because conditional sentence is not always true. There exists some kind of condition, then only that is true. So this is called conditional sentence, is the proposition if P then Q. So I am going to interpret this P implies Q as if P then Q. Proposition P is called antecedent and Q is called consequent. So the conditional sentence P implies Q is true if and only if. So now you can see that I'm going to talk about the definition of conditional sentence P implies Q. So whenever we are stating the definition, I have already told you that we are going to use if and only if. And due to that reason, this kind of if and only if, and that is called biconditional, that kind of connectives comes into picture. So if P is false or Q is true, so what I am going to interpret that this P implies Q and this is true if and only if P is false, or here you can see that here I am going to use the disjunction. So I am telling either P is false or Q is true. So let us try to make this definition simple. So I am going to take the help of this table. So this table is called truth table. So using that table, I can able to give guarantee that which particular sentence or proposition after using connectives are true or false. So here you can see that in previous definition, what I am telling that now I am going to interpret this conditional sentence like P is false or Q is true. It means that P implies Q is true. So I am going to tell that P implies Q is true provided I have P is false, and after that I am going to talk about the or symbol or Q is true. So if these two sentence condition is there, and since or is here, so if P is false and Q is true, then I will claim that P implies Q is true. And try to see here that same kind of message basically we are getting here. So here P is true. So I am telling in here that if P is false, then also this is true. So let us try to see that when P is false, you can see that here P is false and here P is false. Here you can see that I have two, P and Q, two propositions. So maximum combination of that proposition is only four. And due to that reason, I have only four elements in this particular truth table. After that, what I am telling, if P is false, so you can see that corresponding to P is false, and since P is false, we are telling and or Q is true. So just if I will check this, then I can talk about that P implies Q is true. So there is no need to worry about Q, just I have to see that when P is false, and then I am going to match this is true or not. After that, what we are telling that if Q is true, so Q is true, you can see that here Q is true and here Q is true. So again, I am getting Q is true, and using that belief, we have constructed this conditional sentence P implies Q. Okay, so you can see that only one situation, this table or this entry is false when I have this kind of situation that this P is true or Q is false, then I have false. So basically, according to table, what basically we are telling that P implies Q can be false if P is true and Q is false. What does it mean? If you try to interpret this particular line, because only this particular line now is different from all other line, because we are concentrating on this particular conditional statement. So what we found that this conditional statement is true everywhere, just false when P is true and Q is false. So what we are telling, thus this truth table agrees with the way we understand promise. The only situation where a promise is broken is when the antecedent is true, but person making the promise fails to make the consequent true. So here this is antecedent and this is consequent. So consequent is false. So if consequent is false, then we are telling that this entry of this table is false. So now you can see that, note that when we say if P then Q is true, we do not claim that either P or Q is true. So the message of this is very, very important. You can see that what happens in this table, if any P is false and Q is false, then also P implies Q is true. Okay, so by just seeing P implies Q true, I cannot able to claim about P and Q. That is the very, very difficult situation. And due to that reason, if you remember now, several times I am repeating that if P is true and if P implies Q is true, then what is condition? Could you please guess from this table? Dinah, could you please guess from this table? I am telling P is true and P implies Q is true. Then what is value of Q?
P is true.
True. Only one value. Q will never false. Okay. Yes. Have you able to understand this or not? So due to yes, that reason, several times I am repeating this kind of things. If P is true, P implies Q is true, then only Q is true. So whenever we are writing some kind of theorem, then you might be seeing that we are using if and then. So, and something is here, something is here. So suppose here P and Q, then we are telling whatever if means we are assuming something. And after that we are telling then Q, it means that we are assuming that P implies Q is true. And due to that reason, whatever Q, that is also true. So by this table, we are making this kind of comment. But if you are just telling P implies Q is true, I cannot make any kind of conclusion. Why I am not able to make any kind of conclusion? You can see that in second row of this table, P is false and Q is true. Even in that situation also, I have P implies Q is true. Similarly, both are false, then also Q equal to true. And due to that reason, whenever we are writing any theorems, we are taking help of this. That P is true, P implies Q is true, then I can give guarantee that Q is also true. So in this way we are interpreting. But if you are telling that P is true and Q is true, and after that we try to search that what is the situation, so at that situation also I can tell that P implies Q is true. But sometime what happens that if you just see the P implies Q, then I am getting confused, because P truth value of P implies Q cannot tell about P and Q. So in this way I am going to interpret the P implies Q or conditional sentence. So let us try to see one simple example. Suppose that if your friend say like this, if the concert is sold, I will take you the sailing. So let us try to understand this table using this particular conditional statement. So they have make some kind of condition. So they are going to sold out some ticket, and after that they are telling that we will go for boating. So you can see that the promise is broken only when the concert was sold out and the person who made the promise didn't take the person for the sailing. So only one situation this particular sentence is false. In all other situation that is true. It might possible that this concert ticket is not sold. It means that if that is not sold, it means that I have value that is false value. And even if that is not sold, then also your friend is telling, okay, even if that is not sold, I have told you that if sold, we will go. Definitely we will go. But even if that is not sold, but your friend is kind enough to take you for boating. And due to that reason, that kind of possibility is there. Similar kind of things mathematics is also going to interpret. Most of time, whatever mathematics theory is developed based on the interpretation of our daily life routine. Due to that reason, most of time that is not contradicting with our daily life routine or daily life way in which we are communicating with or making promise with the others. And due to that reason, this kind of situation. So please now check other. So that is actually obvious. So I am not going to discuss now. Now I have some more thing that whenever I have P implies Q, then I have two more thing that is called converse and contrapositive. So P implies Q is two proposition, and after that I am going to apply the conditional sentence. So converse of P implies Q is Q implies P. So this, I think that this is very, very obvious. Some of you might not actually recognize about this, that is called contrapositive. So P implies Q is, so what is meaning of contrapositive? That suppose I have some sentence like P implies Q. So I can, whenever we are talking about contraposition of this particular conditional sentence, that is nothing but this is negation sign. So negation Q implies negation of P. So what I am going to do now, I am going to reverse the order, and after that I am going to put the negation sign. Now what basically we are going to do, I am going to check the truth table of P implies Q and Q implies P. Both are same or not. Or P implies Q and contrapositive of Q implies P. So if truth value of this and this are exactly same, then I can tell that P implies Q and negation of Q implies negation of P are exactly equivalent. If that is not, then we are telling that is not equivalent. So in this way, we are defining the converse and contrapositive. And here, this is very, very important. Why this is very, very important, I will tell you in the next part of this lecture. So here, try to understand first. So using example, I am going to demonstrate that how basically some conditional sentence and their converse is connected, or conditional sentence or their contrapositive is connected. So I have taken very, very simple sentence, and means sentence is that if pi is an integer, then 14 is even. So obviously pi is not an integer, so this is false, and after that then 14 is even, so this is basically true. So I have P that is false and I have Q that is true. So could you please tell me that what is value of this? If P is true, and let us come here, P is false and Q is true, then what is P implies Q? Anyone? True. This is true. Okay. So what I am telling that now this sentence, whatever this sentence, this is true. Now try to see the converse. If 14 is even, then pi is an integer. So here 14 is even means P is now true. And after that, we are going to talk about pi is an integer. So obviously pi is not integer. Due to that reason, q is false. So what is value of p implies q? Silpi, what is value of p implies q when p is true and q is false? Could you please comment?
False.
And due to that reason, it means that this original sentence is true, but their converse is false. Okay. So obviously one can make one guess that, okay, if p implies q is true, then their converse is false. Okay. So one kind of, by seeing this example, one can make this kind of observation. But let us check again that this observation is work always or not. After that contrapositive, it means that p implies q and negation of q implies p. So let us see that contraposition position of this particular sentence, that if 14 is even, so 14 is not even. So 14 is not even means this is true or false. Obviously this is false, and here pi is not an integer, that is true sentence. So p is now false and q is true. So obviously my sentence is true from the table, one can see. So please check it. So what we found, that in this particular example, if my proposition, original proposition p implies q, that is true, then their contrapositive is also true, but converse is false. And I am going to take one more statement, and here that conditional statement, if 1 plus 1 equal to 2, then root 10 is greater than 3. So here you can see that 1 plus 1 equal to 2, this is true, and this root 10 greater than 3, that is also true. So p implies q. What is value of p implies q? Anyone? For this sentence, what is this proposition has true value or false value?
True.
Now what I am going to do, I am going to take the converse. How basically we are doing converse? We are just replacing this by this. So now converse sentence is like this: root 10 is greater than 3 and 1 plus 1 equal to 2. So now you can see that this is true and this is true. So again this is true, and contraposition of this, if root 10 is not greater than 3, that is not true. So this is false. 1 plus 1 is not equal to 2, that is false. So false and false, that is also true. It means that here you can see that sentence is true, then converse is also true in this particular example. In previous example, what we have seen, that if this sentence is true, then converse is false. But here what we found, that converse of this sentence is true, and but this contrapositive is maintaining their position. If sentence is true, then this is true. Here this sentence is true, this is true. It is possible to show by checking, or that contrapositive of something that is related. Okay, so due to that reason, what we are telling, observation from last example, the truth value of conditional sentence sentence and it contrapositive are related. There seems little connection between p implies q and it converse. So sometime this is related, sometime this is not related. Due to that reason, we are not going to make some relationship between converse and some kind of conditional sentence. But it is possible to show that conditional sentence and it contrapositive is always related. So due to that reason, we have written p implies q is equivalent. Since whatever truth value of p implies q, same truth value that is going to contain to this particular contrapositive statement. And due to that reason, we are telling that both are equivalent. Please be careful, I am not talking about equal, I am just talking about equivalent. Why I am talking about equivalent? We are just talking about, just we are seeing the truth value of that. Okay, but converse is not equivalent. And whenever we are making proof, sometime assuming p and after that showing p implies q, that is difficult. But if you do reverse, that is contrapositive, then it is very easy to prove. Okay, so when I will teach proof technique, then at that time I will come up with this. And due to that reason, contrapositive of something is very, very important. And one method of proof, that is proof by contraposition. Okay, so now I hope that you are able to understand about the conjunction, disjunction, negation, and conditional sentences, converse and contrapositive. Now let us come to the bidirectional sentence or bidirectional connectives we are going to talk. So we have already seen that this connectives P implies Q in both side is telling that P implies Q, and after that we are telling that I have some kind of here conjunction Q implies P. So either P implies Q and Q implies P, both should be true. So definition is like this: for proposition P and Q, the bidirectional sentence P, and you can read this as a if and only if. So same kind of things I have written here. So whenever we are writing like this, it means that if and then. Okay, whenever I am writing like this, at that time we are writing if and only if. So if and only if, we are interpreting that P, if and only if, is true exactly when both have same truth value. So same truth value means it made possible P is true or Q is true, then only that is true. Similarly, if P is false and Q is false, then again P and if and only if is true. So in table we are going to transmit the same message. You can see that if both value is true, then only this is true. When both value is false, then only this is true. So what does it mean that whenever I have biconditional sentence, then at that time we are assuming that this is also implied, and after that conjunction of this, Q implies P. So both are true. Then only I can tell that P, if and only if, Q. And all definitions are basically right in this particular way. And now you are able to picture out also that whenever I am writing P and Q, so I have told you that P implies Q and negation of Q implies P, negation of P is related. So from here also you can see that P, suppose P is true and Q is true, so what is negation of Q? That is false, and here this is false. So false, false, again that is true. So both are related. Somehow we are not going to distinguish between this and this. Okay. Now, most of time, if you see our nonlinear control literature, people are going to use this, because most of time we are going to state theorems, and in order to state the theorems, we are going to use the conditional sentence or biconditional sentence. So all definitions are written in form of biconditional sentence, but all theorems, lemma, corollary, that is written in form of the conditional statement. So whenever you are going to see this kind of things, you can translate like this: if P, then Q. I have given very, very simple example, and I hope that you are able to check this example. Due to that reason, I am not going to discuss. Just I am going to tell you that what is translation of this. So P implies Q, P is sufficient for Q. So in order to occur Q, P is just sufficient condition. So one can also write like this. Okay, after that P only if Q. So same kind of things one can interpret like this: Q if P, Q whenever P, Q is necessary for P. So you can see that here we are telling that in this sentence P implies Q. Whenever we are telling that P implies Q is true, at that time we are telling that P is sufficient condition for Q. But we are telling that Q is necessary condition for the P. Okay, so this kind of terminology you have to understand. Okay, which is necessary, which is sufficient. So this is very, very important. So translation, you have to translate this in different way, and Q when P. So these kind of translation you have to keep in mind. Okay, now let us try to see the translation of P if and only if. So one is if only if, another is P if but only if Q. So but is also acts like and, I have already told you, due to that reason this is written. P is equivalent to Q, we are also writing. Another one, P is necessary and sufficient condition for Q. It means that whenever this kind of symbol we have, then we are telling that P is not only necessary condition, but also sufficient condition for Q, because P implies Q and Q implies P. So P implies Q, we have just seen now that P is sufficient condition for Q. Okay, now if I will write Q implies P, that is also true. It means that initially P is sufficient condition, now and Q is necessary condition. Now if you exchange it, then Q become sufficient and P become necessary. Due to that reason, whenever we are writing like this, it means that P is necessary and sufficient condition for true. And if you see the literature of nonlinear control system, then these terminology are very, very common. That necessary condition, sufficient condition, necessary and sufficient condition. Okay, so now I hope that you are able to picture out that whenever you have a statement like this, so which one is the sufficient or which one is the necessary. Whenever you have a statement like this, then what is meaning of necessary and sufficient condition? Okay, let us try to take some example from some very simple example, and after that I will come to the control system also. That what is some example from the control system which is talking about necessary and sufficient condition. So a necessary condition is the condition that must be present for the event to occur. So due to that reason, necessary condition is required, and sufficient condition or set of condition that will produce the events. It means that whenever I am telling P implies Q, so P is given. So that kind of condition, necessary condition, is required whenever we are going to see the truth value of this sentence, P implies Q, because all theorems are written here. So if this is not present, P is not present, then I cannot talk about P implies Q. Due to that reason, we are telling that necessary condition is the condition that must be present for an event to occur. So here you can see that what is our event? I am talking about P implies Q. That is our event. So I am telling that P is present. After that, Q condition is the condition or set of condition that can be produced. So if this statement is true, then Q will produce, and the value of Q is true, I have already told you. So a necessary condition must be there, but it alone doesn't provide the sufficient cause for the occurrence of the event. Only the sufficient ground can be do this. In other words, all the necessary element must be present. So if only some necessary element is present, then I cannot tell that P implies Q. Okay, let us try to see here that whenever you are going to learn the nonlinear control system, then you are come up with one stability criteria that is called Lyapunov stability. And believe on me that using these criteria, you can able to understand the nonlinear control theory, robust control theory. Almost every control theory can be interpreted in terms of the Lyapunov stability. So this is one of the most important theory of the nonlinear control system or other branches of applied mathematics. So several necessary conditions that taken together constitute a sufficient condition. So here you can see that what is another one way. Suppose that when I have started this lecture, at that time I am telling that whenever I have to talk the stability of equilibrium point x equal to 0 for this system x dot equal to fx, at that time I am going to construct some ball, epsilon ball, and of output, and here my output is nothing but xt and input is x0. So initial condition, so what we are going to tell, that I am going to construct one ball with respect to output, and there exists a delta, that is function of epsilon, such that if xt0 with respect to 0, so norm I am going to take, and after that if this is true, that xt less like this for all t, then system is stable. So one way to talk about stability, this is like this and this is like this. So if one way to talk in terms of epsilon and delta, another way what you can do, you can just talk stability in terms of energy function. So you can construct one energy function, and whenever we are talking about energy function, that is a scalar function, and that should satisfy these three properties. So if energy function will satisfy this condition, this condition. So this is a necessary condition. V0 should be 0, Vx greater than 0 when D is not equal to 0. So these are the necessary condition, and this condition is also required. So all necessary condition, if that comes at one place, then that will give the sufficient condition of stability checking. It means that if Lyapunov this kind of result is true, then I can claim that x equal to 0 is stable. If that is not true, then I cannot claim. That is the meaning of sufficient condition. If something is true, then I can tell that definitely that event is going to occur. If that is not true, then I cannot comment. Okay, what is meaning of necessary? If something is true, then I can also, if that is not there, then I can tell that that event is not going to occur. That is the meaning of necessary. But sufficient, I cannot talk about the negation of that. Okay, so now I hope that you are able to understand it. Anyone has confusion on this, then please let me know, because this is very, very important. Taslima? Iram?
Yes, sir.
So are you able to understand the difference between necessary condition and sufficient condition?
Yes, sir.
So sufficient condition means if something will occur, okay, something will satisfy, then actually events comes into picture. Okay, if something is not satisfied, then I cannot comment. Okay, it might possible that event will occur or not occur. So if these three conditions will satisfy, then event is definitely occur, means x equal to 0 is stable. But if this is not not satisfied, then I cannot comment. That is the meaning of the sufficient condition. So Lyapunov stability condition is only sufficient condition. But necessary condition means if that is violated, then I can give guarantee that these things will not occur. Okay. Please go ahead.
Sir, from 10 o'clock there is another class actually, you know, digital control.
Oh, okay. Okay, then what I will do, now I am going to end the lecture here. Okay. So in this way we are going to interpret the necessary and sufficient condition. Okay, and in next class what I will do, I am going to talk about the further part, that is the quantifiers. Okay, so what we have seen in today's lecture, so in today's lecture I have talked about the connectives, after that conditional and biconditional sentences, and after that we are talking about truth table. And we are going to interpret the truth table in some way. And after that, what we found, that necessary condition and necessary and sufficient condition, what is use of this condition to nonlinear control theory. So at this moment, we are not able to understand why, what is meaning of this theorem. But at least we are able to understand that V0 equal to 0 is the necessary condition. Vx greater than 0 is necessary condition. And implication of these all are sufficient condition. Okay, so now with this remark, I am going to end the today's lecture. So do you have any confusion, anyone up to here? Then please let me know.